Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's call to us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
May God be with you. Let us pray. Threefold one, relationship in unity, love given and received through all the ages long. Give us that unity which is not enclosed, but alive and accepting with the open heart of love, through Jesus Christ, the glory of God.
Amen.
Said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This is Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem, from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James son of Alphaeus and Simon the Zealot, and Judas son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice in so far as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled in the name of Christ, you are blessed, because of the glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves, keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, crawls around, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be power forever and ever. Amen. Hear the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Savior Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
It is a real privilege and pleasure for me to be at St. Mary's today. I've been to this church on a number of occasions in the past, but this is my first time to come here as bishop, and it is a real joy. But today, it's a joy that is also touched by poignancy. I came to this diocese 14 years ago as canon pastor, and it was from that role that I was then elected bishop. But over all those years, I came to be a very good friend of your rector, Father Joel Mason. And today is his last confirmation class, and we are just a couple of weeks away from his last service after 18 years leading this congregation. I will speak for myself, but I know that you would say the same, that I will miss him terribly when he goes from the Diocese of New York. He has been a stalwart, great pillar of clerical wisdom in Westchester County, and he has led this church well over many, many years. I didn't know that we were scheduling my visitation to coincide so closely with his retirement, though that may have been planned. But I am very, very happy that it is, so that I can be part of this celebration, these last weeks of celebration, of all that he has done in this church over these years. But it is also great to be here with you all. I have people in this parish that are friends that I know quite well, and to be with this wonderful confirmation class. I know that they've spent years working through the program Journey to Adulthood with Father Mason. They're very, very well prepared for confirmation. And I know that we have among them great leaders for the future of the church. So this is a glorious day for St. Mary's and for the church. And my pleasure to be here and to be with you for it. I'm only sorry that my wife Margaret isn't here. She had looked forward to coming. She has a couple of doctor appointments, nothing urgent, but she needs to go prescriptions and things, I don't know, but they're very early tomorrow morning up in Poughkeepsie, so she needed to take the train up today and take our daughter with her. It's a long story, but anyway, so I when I first heard the story, I stopped being able to hear it about halfway through. but There's a good reason why she's not here. I don't know the whole story, but there is. And she sends her regards and her very best wishes to you. She is sorry not to be here, and sorry not to be with Joel and Mary John. So anyway, my pleasure to be here. This is the seventh Sunday of Easter. It is the Sunday after Ascension Day, and it is to my mind, the weirdest Sunday of the year in the church calendar. I'm going to tell you why that is here as I talk. But it falls between the Ascension and Pentecost, which I've come to think of as 10 strange days. And let me talk to you a little bit about why I feel that way and something about the Ascension and what that may have to say to us in our own lives. But let me start by telling a little story. Before I came to New York, I was for not 18 years, but about 12, the rector of a church in Western Massachusetts. And one Saturday in the spring, I decided to take the young people of my parish hiking on a Saturday. Now, some of them liked to hike and some didn't, so I chose a very easy hike. We decided to drive up into the Berkshires and to hike up to the top of Mount Greylock. Now, Mount Greylock is the highest point in Massachusetts, but that's not saying much. It's about 3,000 feet, and the hike is long and gentle as it moves up to the top, and I knew that even the people who didn't like to hike would be able to do that. So we packed picnic lunches, and off we went. Through the morning, we hiked up through the woods on our way to Mount Greylock, and about lunchtime, we got to the top. And now, there's different ways to get to the top of Mount Greylock. You can hike up the trail, or you can drive your car and park in the parking lot. So when we came up out of the woods, we were in the parking lot, and there's a ranger station there, and to my surprise, the parking lot was filled with cars. And it was the first really nice Saturday of the spring, and so people were out, but this crowd was a specific group of people. It was a big hang gliding club. And so all over around the parking lot and on the grass and at the top of this mountain, everybody was getting their hang gliders ready. And now I'm a person who enjoys nothing as much as to talking to somebody who's really passionate about something that I don't know anything about. They're very glad to talk about what it is that they love doing. And you can learn some things along the way. So we got up there and I walked around and people showed me their hang gliders and explained them to me and showed how they strapped themselves in and talked about the strategy of what you do when you're in the air. And I found it all very interesting. Plus, the hang gliders were beautiful, like kites, green and blue and yellow and red and orange and rainbow colored and everything. And so it was a glorious day, kind of like this one today. So it's just great to be out there with all of these people. But then after a little while came the time when they were going to start hang gliding. So the people from my parish and I, we got our picnics and we went and sat down at a place where we could watch them take off and eat our lunch. Well, there was a boy, looked to me to be about 14 years old, and this was his first time ever of hang gliding. So they were going to let him go first. I think to help keep him from chickening out. And so he had the hang glider on his back. And now you need to get a sense of the topography of this mountain. We came up the long way up a very, very gentle slope. But when you get to the top, if you cross over the top, there's a cliff. I mean, it's not giant, but it goes straight down for a ways. And then it slopes down towards the town of Adams, Massachusetts. And so the plan was you would run off that cliff. So the boy had the hang glider on his back, and he got way back, and they were all very encouraging of him, and he took off, and he ran to the edge of the cliff and stopped, teetering on the edge. He just couldn't quite go off the edge. Well, they were very encouraging of him, applauding, great, you'll do it this time, and he got way back, and he ran again, got up to the edge, again, couldn't quite do it, teetering, afraid to go. And this lasted for about four or five times. Well, with each time, their encouraging applause became more tepid. Well, he was holding everybody else up. So finally, he got back to make another attempt, but one of the men came over, and he said, "It's okay. You'll do it next time." And went to move him out of the way. And the boy stood there for a second, and then he turned, and he ran off the cliff. Now, the winds that come into that
part of the country, up in that area, come from the west and the north. So when they come and hit Mount Greylock, they're mostly coming towards that cliff, and they come across the town of Adams, and they go up that slope, and when they get to the cliff, they go straight up. So when the boy ran off the cliff, as soon as he went off the edge, those winds picked him up and threw him about 100 feet over our heads in no more time than it takes to tell it. I mean, he ran off that cliff. It wasn't like Wile E. Coyote 10 feet out realizing where he is. He took a step off that cliff and he was thrown into the air. And in an instant, he was circling 100 feet over our heads, circling on that kite, on that hang glider. And right after him, here they came. You know, all of the other hang gliders, anxious to get into the sky. And within, you know, just a few minutes, 5 minutes, there were 75 or 80 hang gliders up in the air, some of them really high, some of them not so high, some of them broad swoops, some of them closer. But the air just was filled with these people on these beautiful hang gliders, all those great colors circling in the air. Well, I sat there eating my lunch and looking at them, and I felt left behind. And so we watched and we ate our lunch, and then the time came to go back down the mountain. We began our hike back down. And that feeling of being left behind was actually something I was feeling pretty strongly. And I'm not a scaredy cat. I do a lot of mountain climbing and hiking. I did when my knees were better. And I've taken some risks, probably some of them foolishly. So it's not that I would be afraid to go hang gliding. It's just that it seemed on that day that there were two ways of being. You could crawl back down the mountain on the ground, or you could fly. And the difference was the edge of that cliff. And the question was, can you run off this cliff? And I couldn't. And we went back down the mountain, and they were circling above us over the woods. And I found myself embarrassed and glad that the trees were covering. And they couldn't see me crawling back down the mountain like an insect as they soared above me like hawks. And I thought about that for a long time. And the reason I'm telling it today, because that's years ago, and it stayed with me in some beautiful and poignant and wistful ways. But the reason I'm saying it today is that when I look at pictures of the Ascension, and you see Jesus on his way, and the disciples standing around looking up at the soles of his feet, and usually you see them looking at the soles of his feet. That's a very common image for ascension. I kind of know how they feel. I think they felt left behind. And I think that they felt wistful. And I think they had some intimation that there were two ways of being. And there was another way to live, another way of being that was majestic and wonderful and filled with miracles and wonders. But you had to be able to run off the cliff after Jesus. And they didn't know how to do that. And what we see on the Ascension is the fulfillment of Jesus' statement to the disciples on the night before he died at the Last Supper. I'm going, and where I'm going, you cannot come. And the Ascension came, and he went somewhere they couldn't go. So that when we look at the 10-day period between Ascension and Pentecost, the reason I call them 10 strange days is it seems to me that what we're looking at is the perceived or actual experience of the disciples of living for a while with the absence of God. And waiting for the Pentecost, something which they had been promised but could not possibly understand. We see them in the reading that we have today, out watching Jesus ascend to heaven, and then going back to the upper room, where they've been hiding out since Easter, and where they're going to stay hiding out until the Pentecost. Nothing has happened for the disciples to give them yet the capacity to run off that cliff. They have been given hints and intimations of a bolder, braver, more faithful way of living. Something more adventurous and true to the high calling they have from God, but they don't know how to live it. They have experienced and witnessed the resurrection, but it has not yet made any change in their lives. They are caught in the in-between during these 10 days. And I see them there feeling like I felt, unable to go where Jesus went, seeing the edge of that cliff and backing away from it and waiting and probably feeling shame, embarrassment, confusion, uncertainty about what it now means to be a disciple. For Jesus was raised from the dead on Easter with a promise that out of his rising, the Holy Spirit would be poured upon the disciples, and it hasn't happened yet. Now we can leap ahead to see the Pentecost, the coming of the Spirit, and these people leaving the upper room and never returning to it. Leaving the upper room and traveling to Europe and southern India and all the way through Asia Minor, down into Africa, spreading the gospel, becoming the apostles, spreading the Christian message of the coming of the kingdom of heaven. After the Pentecost, they all ran right off the cliff. When they were filled with the Holy Spirit, they ran right off the cliff. When they were made as brave and strong and faithful as Jesus by the Spirit of God that dwelt in Jesus, now dwelling within them, they were afraid of nothing in this world. And we see what happened and what became of that. But on ascension, we find them in that confusing in-between place. And the reason why I think it's important to talk about that and to think about their experience of the absence of God, it says, I think a whole lot of time in our own lives, we live in that same place. Now, it may be, and it is true, that through baptism and the sacraments of the church, we have in fact been the receivers of the Holy Spirit. That Spirit has come into us. But I think that one of the things that's complicated for Christians is to live with that and begin to understand and to know what that power is that comes from the Spirit and what it can mean for the transformation of our own lives. So that we live often in the in-between time. We have received the promises of God and we have been told by Jesus, you will do greater things than I. And that is a confusing and frightening message and we're not quite sure what to do with it. Let me say, we stand with the cliff in front of us. Can we run off that cliff? And that's the question that came to the disciples. They said, no, we cannot. Jesus said, I'm going where you cannot come. They said, yeah, we get that. We cannot come. But that cliff stands as the place for every person who hears and responds to the call of Christ as the threshold into that greater new life, the different way of being that Jesus promises when he talks about the inbreaking of the kingdom of heaven, the coming of the kingdom of God. But this is the good news, too, about ascension. Remember that this is not the fulfillment of Easter. This is the fulfillment of Christmas. On Christmas, God came down as Christ into the world. And when Jesus came into the world, he came pure and innocent as a newborn baby. And the Apostle John said, we beheld his glory. Glory as of the only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. But when Jesus went back on ascension, which is the other bookend to Jesus' earthly ministry, he went with nail holes through his hand. The flesh of his temples, forehead, and scalp thrashed and torn by the thorns, with a spear wound in his side, his back covered with the ripped flesh and scars of the scourging he received the night before his crucifixion. When Jesus ascended back, it was not as the pure, fresh baby who would come among us. It was as someone who had experienced and now could take into the very lived experience of God the full brunt of what it means to live in a world of sin and division and violence and hatred. So that doesn't sound like good news. But the good news in it is that I think it is fair to say that until the adventure that God entered into, when God ran over his own cliff and came to be among us as a human person, until then, the human condition was a mystery to God. And when we come before God with our prayers, and we raise up before God the terrible things that we have done to other people for which we need to be forgiven, and the terrible things that have been done to us that break us down and which we need to forgive, the fears, confusions, and the dreams and desires of our own lives, every hope, every failure, every victory, every tragedy that we have lived through in our lives, and we raise these up before God in our prayers, we may say after the ascension, God gets it. He gets us. For Jesus has taken all of that into the lived experience of God through the ascension. So that we wind up with, when we contemplate and think about Ascension Day, we wind up with two different lessons, I think, that live side by side in every human life, and that are both the complexity and poignancy of our own living, but also the repository of our hopes. And that is that part of the experience of being human is living with the perceived or actual absence of God, like the disciples experienced after the ascension. But the other part of it is this assurance that whatever silence of God, absence of God, or fears about God that may touch and temper our own lives, God knows who we are with the intimacy of one who has had our lives brought into him and made God's own experience. So that Ascension Day is confusing. It is for me. It is for me. It is a confusing teaching out of the experience of Christ. But it suggests to me that there may not be many other places that speak so profoundly to what it means to be a human being who has been called to a great new life through Christ in God, who has been called to the extraordinary adventure of what it means to live a fully human life as lived by Jesus, and yet at the same time be filled with every fear about that and every inability to cross that line and run off that cliff. Jesus is calling us forward into something new, something different, something greater, something astonishing. I don't know how to get there. I engage the life of faith that somehow, some way, in my living, Jesus will teach me how to run off that cliff and be thrust into the presence of God. Amen.
Stage directions as the confirmands and those being received come forward during the singing of the next hymn. I would like for you to know that if you are a parent or a sponsor of confirmands or those being received, and you'd like to step forward and place your hand on the shoulder of the person while the bishop places hands on them, you are invited to come forward and do so. I'd also like to ask my server to get the altar, and for the bishop's chaplain, carry this chair to the center. Please stand. I think that's it. Come, Holy Ghost, our souls inspire. Thank you.
are not being presented today for confirmation or reception may be seated. May I say to those of you who are, I won't go so far as to say that this sacrament of confirmation is the edge of the cliff. But I will say that you are entering into a new season of your life as Christians. Remember that the life to which Christ is calling you is wonderful, it is venturous, it is costly, and it makes all the difference in the world. We pray that through this confirmation and in the days and years to come, God will make you brave and strong in faith for that call. The candidates for holy baptism, the candidates for confirmation will not be presented.
If the candidates for confirmation would please stand in this space. Those being received would stand here.
There's more of you all, so maybe you want to move down here a little bit where everybody is.
Bishop, I present these persons to be confirmed. I present this person to be received on behalf of the rector and wardens of the Church of St. John in Pleasantville. I present Jenny to be received.
To those of you so presented, do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil?
You know what? I think you need a
booklet. You can probably share. Same thing. I'm gonna make Now, a moment ago I asked you if you reaffirm your renunciation of evil, and I'm quite certain that you do. But it was a somewhat half-hearted response. So, we're going to try it again. Do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil?
I do.
Do you renew your commitment to Jesus Christ?
I do.
Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ?
We will.
Then let us stand and join with those who are committing themselves to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers?
I will, without self.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let us now pray for the church, the world, and these persons who have renewed their commitment to Christ.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. For the Holy Church of God in every place, and especially for this parish and diocese, and for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Catherine, our presiding bishop, for Andy, our diocesan, Alan, our suffragan, and for Joel, our rector, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the confirmants and those being received who having been baptized into the communion of this church, confirm their commitment to Christ this day. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the welfare of the world, for this nation and its leaders, for Chappaqua, and for every city and community, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, the suffering, the hungry, and the lonely, and those in any need or trouble, especially Taya, Viola, Rick, Steve, Quan, Scott, Aldo, Patricia and family, Vicky, Chris, Dominic and family, Jordan, Roy and family, Carrie, Kathy and family, Katie, Armand, Fran, Norbert, Amy, Scott and family, and John. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In the communion of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord our God.
Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Let us now pray for these persons who have renewed their commitment to Christ. Almighty God, we thank you that by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, you have overcome sin and brought us to yourself, and that by the sealing of the Holy Spirit, you have bound us to your service. Renew in these your servants the covenant you made with them at their baptism. Send them forth in the power of that Spirit to perform the service you set before them, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Defend, O Lord, your servant Chris with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until he comes to your everlasting kingdom. Defend, O Lord, your servant Matthew with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever,
and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more until he comes to your everlasting kingdom. Defend, O Lord, your servant Ram with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until he comes to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. Amen. Defend, O Lord, your servant Lyle with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more until he comes to your everlasting kingdom. Defend, O Lord, your servant Katie with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until she comes to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. Amen. Defend, O Lord, your servant Louis with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until he comes to your everlasting kingdom. Defend, O Lord, your servant Jane with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until she comes to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. Defend, O Lord, your servant Alexis with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until she comes to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. Defend, O Lord, your servant Susan with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until she comes to your everlasting kingdoms. Amen. Amen. Defend, O Lord, your servant Charles with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until he comes to your everlasting kingdom. Amen. Amen. Defend, O Lord, your servant Christy with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until she comes to your everlasting kingdom. Defend, O Lord, your servant Hannah with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until she comes to your everlasting kingdom. Amen.
Defend, O Lord, your servant Duri with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until she comes to your everlasting kingdom. Amen.
Amen.
Defend, O Lord, your servant Leon with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until he comes to your everlasting kingdom. Amen.
Amen.
Linda, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, and we receive you into the fellowship of this communion. God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and hold you. Jenny, we recognize you as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, and we receive you into the fellowship of this communion. God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep. Amen. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, look down upon these your servants. Let your fatherly hand ever be over them. Equip them for the life and the work that you give them to do, and bring them finally to that heavenly kingdom where they may dwell with you and your Son, Jesus Christ, in eternity. Amen.
Amen.
Beloveds, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Good morning. Good to see you this morning. Welcome. If you're visiting with us, we especially welcome you. We'd like for you to know that the Church of St. Mary's Virgin, we consider this to be God's table, not ours. If you feel moved by God to come and receive communion, by all means join us as we stand in a half circle around the altar, placing one hand over the other to receive bread, or you can open your mouth and the bishop will place the bread in your mouth. We do use real wine in our communion service. If you don't want to drink wine, just fold your arms across your chest. Chalices will pass you by. If you would like to come forward but not receive communion, you may do that as well by folding your arms across your chest and receive a pontifical blessing, right, from the bishop. Immediately after the service in the parish hall right behind the church, there will be a reception for the candidates and a chance for you to meet the bishop. Well, they're not candidates anymore, for the newly confirmed and received, and an opportunity for you to meet and speak with the bishop as well. Also, the vestry, since the bishop had a little bit of car trouble this morning, we will take a few minutes right after the reception to meet with the bishop, and then we will try to get to Kittle House at 12:45 for our brunch with the bishop. The announcements are printed on the back of the booklet. And are there any other announcements that need to be made this morning? Yes.
Yeah, it feels a little odd making a commercial announcement during this beautiful service, but we're 6 days out, so I need to do so. Good morning, everyone. The Strawberry Festival is this coming Saturday. I haven't dared look at the Law Ridge forecast yet, so if you have, don't tell me what it says. But hopefully we'll have lots of sunshine. Okay, a few items. We do still need volunteers for the afternoon. I have a funny feeling there are some of you that plan to be there that just may not have filled in a slot yet. Please do let me know, because now I'm to the point where I'm starting to make desperate phone calls really need to fill up those logs if we can. I know this is a little late in the game, but we are taking donations of canned soda and water from our parishioners that we will sell that day. Last year, that was a donation from ShopRite. They are donating again this year, but in a different way. So if anyone can do that during the week and drop off at the parish hall, that would be wonderful. They are on sale at ShopRite right now, so please consider that. Bake sale items. Mary Ann Baer is generously heading up that area, and we need to know who is bringing what. So if you are planning to bake, please let her know that. Raffles. If please continue to sell them. We have booklets here. Denise Hanchett has been heading that up. If you have sold them and you're not going to be at the festival, please drop them off with the money during the week. Right, Denise, to Lorraine?
Yes, yep. Put them in an envelope that says raffle with the tickets and the money. And give them to Lorraine, please.
Yes.
Before Saturday. Unless you're going to be at the Strawberry Festival, please give them right to me. I'll be there all day.
Thank you. Yes, please continue to sell those. And not too late for attic treasures. Looks like we are getting a nice collection in there, but if you're doing any cleaning out of your closets, we'll still continue to take them. So please do. I think that's it.
Yes, Mary.
Yeah.
Friday night, we need help hauling and getting things organized for the bake sale. Right.
Yes, Friday, I believe at 5, 6 o'clock. Yeah, I think 6 o'clock. I'll send out a blast email on that. So yes, volunteers for that evening. Although we are pretty well covered, but we'll take whoever we can get.
Well, here's some strawberry trivia that you might not be aware of. We have one parishioner that still remembers the very first one. Ralph Holland. He was at the first one. He said they drug out tables behind the sacristy and sat out there and had strawberries and shortcake, and that was about the extent. Look what we did to it. Yeah.
When was the first one?
It was 76 years ago.
77.
Tom just keeps on playing. But Ralph remembers the very first one. On a personal note, I want to thank you, Bishop Dietsche, for being with us today.
My great pleasure.
For the wonderful message you gave us, and yes, it was planned. And it's a very powerful service, I thought, and it has been a blessing for me to go through this process with these young men and women, and the men and women who were confirmed and received as well. I've just been very touched by it and blessed. It's a wonderful way to complete my ministry here at St. Mary's. Also want to say a special welcome to another sitting over here at the piano. Stephen Fancher is here today as well, helping out with music and being a very good and conscientious confirmation sponsor. We were at the cookout last night. He's already acclimated to Sarasota. He said, this is like winter. He almost froze. So, thank you, Bishop. Thank you, Steve. Any other announcements?
Hello, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Liam Fenlon. And tonight at 6 p.m. here at the church, I'll be having a cello recital as kind of a culmination of everything that I've been working on this year. So I'd love to see you here. And my Aunt Davina is very generous and bakes a lot of delicious goods. So we can enjoy those afterwards. So at 6 p.m. here. Thank you.
If you want to cap off a wonderful day, this is the way to do it. An amazing challenge. Ascribe to God. Well, do I do this or do you do this?
Go ahead.
All right. Ascribe to God, the honor due God's name. Moving off of you. Oh, you got one more? Okay.
Hi, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Katie Dion. I'm also kind of promoting myself a little bit. In 2 weeks, actually, on June 11th at 7 o'clock p.m. At Horace Greeley High School, there will be a performance of a play that I wrote and directed for my school playwriting directing class. And I would really appreciate it if some of you could make it. It's free admission, so if
dropping
by, I'd really like to see some of your faces. Thank you.
That's June 11th at 7?
Yeah, 7.
At Horace Greeley High School in the auditorium.
Yeah.
Anybody else? Ascribe to God, the honor to God's name. Bring offerings. Come into God's court.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
All thanks and praise are yours, at all times and in all places, our true and loving God, through Jesus Christ, your eternal Word, the wisdom from on high, by whom you created all things. You laid the foundations of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out of the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey. And so as the morning stars sing your praises, we join the heavenly king. We join the heavenly beings and all creation as we shout with joy.
Oh.
You called a people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign, and give himself for us a fragrant offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection and ascension, longing for Christ's coming in glory, and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ.
Dying, you destroy our death. Rising, you restore our life.
Christ Jesus,
come in glory.
Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time gather us with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary and all your people into the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit,
We worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise.
Blessed are you, now and forever. Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray.
Our Father,
Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Holy things for holy people.
Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. May we never offer to God
offerings that cost us nothing.
Go in peace to love and serve God.
We will seek peace and pursue it.
In the name of the Trinity of perfect love.
One God in perfect community.